Welcome back, YouTubers, to another WrestleMania review as part of our WrestleMania review series, gearing you guys up for WrestleMania 28 by reviewing WrestleMania 14 to 27. Well, we're going to be reviewing WrestleMania 23 in this review, aren't we, NJ?
We are indeed, 23.
Oh, guys, in case you didn't realise already, after the first, 14 to 22 we did reviews, with the British Fist.
Ka-ching!
I'm Mr. Parkin, and this guy sitting next to me is the one and only. Do you smell what he's cooking? It's NJ.
What's up?
And yes, like I said, WrestleMania 23 review in this video, guys. Make sure you subscribe above, like this video, and comment your thoughts on WrestleMania 23 down in that comment section below.
And make sure you contact us in the links in the box below.
Yeah, so WrestleMania 23, NJ, the whole thing, it was an all-grown-up special, all-grown-up theme. We had 80,000 people filling up the Ford Field in Detroit. Our favourite commentators on Raw, Jim Ross, Jerry Lawler, Michael Cole, JBL on SmackDown, and Joey Styles and Taz on ECW. This is the first preview they did where the ECW brand would be part of the card. There's Vince soon buried that return, didn't he?
I'm all grown up now, yeah. Stephanie McMahon song just comes to mind. Anyway.
But we had 8 matches on this card, and I think one thing we both quipped to each other during this review was, how much stuff are we skipping on this review? Because it was so much filler. And a lot of it was because of that all grown up thing. You had those vignettes and stuff. But there was a lot of filler on this card. And it really dragged the WrestleMania down a bit, in my opinion.
Well, we did skip some backstage segments. Could have been entertaining. We got to see legends and that. But we just wanted to get to what actually mattered in wrestling business, which is wrestling matches.
And there was about an hour, 40 minutes of actual wrestling, which just isn't good enough for WrestleMania, in my opinion. You at least need 2 hours, half the show, to be wrestling. But so there was a lot of filler on this show. But what we got in this card, it was apparently it got the highest WrestleMania buy rate in history, 1.2 million people buying it.
If they can explain why people who bought this, then please do.
Ric Flair and Carlito defeated Gregory Helms and Charlo Guerrero in a dark match.
Wow, what a match!
Exactly, a tag team lumberjack match, which went about 5 minutes. Ric Flair in a dark match, because you're not just putting him in the Money in the Bank for the second year, that would have been pretty cool.
It would have been good, because obviously with Ric Flair still being around, still involved in his wrestling time, it would have been good if he did get another Money in the Bank, because you have like Finlay in this one appearing again, so
you can tell Finlay was a booker in WWE when he got involved in Money in the Bank. And also here we got Chavo Guerrero the year before his 8-second beat by Kane. Dark match to 8-second match. You know, Chavo never really got too much of a push. But there we go. We'll start off with the Money in the Bank ladder match. This is always a good way to start Mania. I think this is the first time it started Mania, wasn't it? CM Punk, Mr. Kennedy, Jeff Hardy, Matt Hardy, Edge, Randy Orton, King Booker, and Finlay. Like we said, you can tell Finlay was a booker in WWE. He got himself in these matches pretty much time. You had a good mixture of veterans, new stars, and high flyers, which made this match kind of good, because you have all the high flyers, you have all the star power. So this was a nice way to start the show, in my opinion.
Well, with the wrestlers that we got in this one, again, there were guys who obviously were going to progress somewhere and needed a big match like this on Mania. Mm-hmm. Something in this match, it had the right wrestlers in. Some of them you could like doubt, thinking, not really. Finlay was a big example. But overall, it had wrestlers in that you wanted to see on Mania, and they got this match, so I liked it.
And like I said, Money in the Bank is always a great way to start the card, because it gets the crowd pumped. You know, you've got all these guys in the ring doing crazy ass spots, and you had that crazy spot with Jeff going off the massive ladder to the outside of the ring on Edge, and even though there was a massive pause because of that, because Edge got injured or something like that, I think it was still a good, it flowed pretty well. It wasn't as good as 21, which was the first one, but it was definitely better than 22, and I think having the right guy winning it kind of helped it a little bit.
Again, when it comes to the winner of this, obviously we can go into detail about the winner of this, because obviously the WWE must have had plans for this,
definitely.
But it didn't go as far as it should have done.
No, unfortunately, injuries got in the way of Mr. Kennedy won. He was the right guy to win. He was a burgeoning star in WWE. And even though he didn't do too much in the match, he still won it. But he was the right guy. It's just a shame that injuries kind of meant that he never really got a shot, and Edge ended up getting it instead and winning the title later on when Undertaker got a legit injury.
Again, it would have been great if the WWE actually did go ahead with Mr. Kennedy. Maybe he would have stuck around in WWE. Maybe he would have become a good champion. And it would have been good. But obviously, the injuries really... This match was good, but the outcome obviously didn't go as far as WWE were planning on, so it's kind of a letdown in that.
But it was still a very good match. But long term, you know, it was Anderson getting injuries, so there's nothing really WWE could have helped there. But and Randy Orton getting him fired, that's taking it to a whole nother level, brother.
And obviously, in the match, you had Randy Orton obviously doing his normal thing, which was RKing everyone, and everyone had their own spot in this match, so it made it somewhat good for each wrestler in the match.
So a nice way to open up the card, Money in the Bank ladder match. It's just a shame this next match could never really follow it. Great Khali versus Kane. I know your favourite guy is Kane, and he was just coming off the See No Evil film, which I know you loved a lot, MJ, but this match stunk.
Again, again, with this, the way I was talking about it with Dan during it and afterwards, it's kind of like me thinking that this was Carly's Mania match to give him some kind of push in a direction that was going to be good for his career. But at the same time, the match was short.
Five and a half minutes.
It was a big guy versus big guy, but it didn't actually have a proper, real big Mania feel to it.
No.
It was basically more for Carly than anything.
They tried to live the whole WrestleMania 3 Hogan versus Andre thing with Kane doing the body slam, and it never really worked. You know, Carly was brought in really strong against Undertaker, and he got that World Heavyweight Championship run later in the year, mainly because of injuries. So, you know, what do you really say about this?
That's it.
Yeah, that's all we got. Chris Benoit versus MVP in the match for the US Championship. The US Championship match gets on the card. High five for that.
Oh, yeah.
Just a shame the Intercontinental Champion match was in a match which wasn't really about him, but there we go. They brought MVP in very strong, didn't they? They had him in the crowd and bringing him as the highest paid guy on SmackDown. They had him have that cheerleader entrance. So they made him feel like a special guy in the sense that the way they presented him up until WrestleMania.
Well, with him getting a Mania match was a big thing for MVP, and for him to get a championship match as well against someone as big as Chris Benoit, who sadly we've seen over the years go up from the main event to the US.
But at the same time,
he's a guy that could put people over. Yep. He didn't do it with MVP tonight, but obviously the feud did continue, which was a good thing for these two wrestlers.
Yeah, the feud did continue until Judgment Day, where MVP would win 2-0 in a 2 out of 3 falls match. But later on afterwards, that Benoit would die later on in the year, unfortunately, of course. And that's led to the whole wellness policy thing. You know, what do you really say about that? Later on, he was supposed to win the ECW Championship because he got drafted. But the match itself was decent. It didn't really get enough time to be a great good to great match, but it was still decent with the time it got, 9 minutes. Chris Benoit gets the victory with the headbutt. I really felt this would have been a nice time to make MVP win, but he won later on in the feud, and he looked pretty good in this match.
Well, with Chris Benoit already had his big WrestleMania moment, so maybe this was his time to put another guy over, and MVP, why not put MVP over at one of the biggest stages of them all?
Yeah, even though he's not even with the WWE anymore. A shame, really. So that was a decent match.
I enjoyed it. It was a good match for both of them.
And a decent feud, too. I mean, Benoit and MVP. Just a shame we didn't get as much out of MVP as we really probably should have in the WWE. And maybe even Benoit, too. We don't even know. Just want a quick note while we're here. While we're recording this video, on the day we're recording this video, it's like, what, the 10th of February, 9th of February, 11th of February. I can't even remember. It's the 10th of February. Mr. Perfect died 9 years ago, which is why I want to bring this up. The WWE Hall of Fame. In the WWE Hall of Fame, we have Dusty Rhodes, of course, a legend. Jerry the King Lawler and Jim Ross, our favourite commentators. You also have Mr. Fuji, the original Sheik, the Wild Samoans, Nick Bockwinkle, don't know who he is. But more importantly, Mr. Perfect Kurt Hennig was in this year's Hall of Fame. And it's quite fitting how on the day when a couple of years before he died, we see him on Hall of Fame on the day that he died 9 years ago.
It's a big thing, because obviously with it being Hall of Fame, you're going to have big names in it, and this is what we got. And for it be Kurt, I think it didn't have the biggest of names, but it was a Hall of Fame with big names.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't the biggest, but it's still well worth mentioning. Batista versus The Undertaker for the World Heavyweight Championship. Taker won the Royal Rumble, obviously had the streak at the time. I think he was 13-0 or 14-0, I can't really remember. And Batista was the top guy, one of the top guys on SmackDown who had the World Heavyweight Championship. So this really probably should have been a lot higher up than fourth on the fucking card, shouldn't it? With everything that happened behind it. The Royal Rumble winner, Batista.
Well, the thing about this is that obviously Taker, a big name as he is, and obviously for it to be a championship match, with Batista and his growth in WWE, the place in the card, unless the other matches that we're going to get to later, in my opinion, it was in the wrong place.
Definitely in the wrong place, especially considering how big this match was and how good it was as well, because it was a very good match. I did really enjoy this match. The crowd were really into Taker. They didn't really get into Batista that much. He was, I believe, with a babyface. But it was still a good match. It got 16 minutes. Decent amount of time for this match. Told a good story. I thought this was a good match. Definitely. Just a shame it was buried in the mid-card.
Well, the video package before really hyped this match up. Really got us, obviously, as it's a past WrestleMania, it got us to relive this.
Yep.
Got us to get behind the match. And I'm thinking, the way it went, it did tell a good story. And overall, yeah, we all knew that Taker was going to win because the streak was going to continue getting stronger. But Batista did put on a great fight, and overall, it was just a good match for both wrestlers.
Yeah, a really good match, just the wrong place on the card, really, I think, in my opinion. The feud continued on as well after going into Backlash. And then you had Edge winning Money in the Bank because Taker got a legit injury, so Edge ended up winning the title with the Money in the Bank. So crazy things there between the Money in the Bank and the World Heavyweight Championship match. But still a great, still a good match, good WrestleMania match. After that, ECW got on the card. The one time Joey Styles and Taz got to commentate. The ECW originals, consisting of Sandman, Tommy Dreamer, and Rob Van Dam and Sabu, versus the new breed, Elijah Burke, Matt Striker, Marcus Corvin, and Kevin Thorne. Do you remember back when the ECW product was on like Thursday nights or something, Tuesday nights? Did you really have any interest in it?
Oh no.
Why was that?
It's just that obviously the wrestlers in there weren't real like big, huge names. Mm. The wrestlers that I could actually get behind and want to see progress in that. Yes, it had at the time there was names that obviously
Van Damme and stuff like that. Yeah.
But it weren't big enough for me to show interest.
It was kind of like a third brand, wasn't it? Vince did a really good job of burying that company with his freaking ego.
And the fact that they get a WrestleMania match with this, I didn't care. It didn't feel like, oh, this is going to be a great match for WrestleMania. It's just, I didn't show much interest in this.
I think the thing is with me, you had the originals versus the new breed. That is a good concept if you're going to be bringing in these new guys in ECW to your product. The ECW's originals came from the crowd. It was kind of like a feel-good moment for the ECW fans who did get some one-night stand pay-per-views and a December to Dismember to not remember. But it's just the fact that you had an 8-man tag and the match went 6.5 minutes. Just too quick. Why did you? I mean, and then you realise where all that time goes when you get to the next segment.
Which was disappointing, but at the same time, it wasn't a match I really cared about. But again, if it was going to do so in the future of the WWE, maybe it should have got more time. But sadly, this didn't really last much longer.
Surprise, surprise, Rob Van Dam gets the win. And it's kind of funny how a lot of these guys ended up in TNA.
TNA.
Shows you how far some of those guys have come or how much Vince buried that business. But there we go. Just not a good segment in our opinion. Going on to the next match. Billionaire versus Billionaire, the Battle of the Billionaires, as it was called. This had a lot of media buzz at the time, didn't it? Vince McMahon versus Donald Trump, and this is one of the things that I believe got that really high buy rate. The media buzz surrounding this at the time was ridiculously good, wasn't it?
Well, with the whole storyline going up to this, I was like, okay, you're bringing a celebrity. Like I've said in the past, bringing celebrities is not my ideal thing. Mm. It was a big name that obviously people in the US were really behind. The fact that he got involved with Vince McMahon helped this storyline and made a draw for this WrestleMania.
Yeah, I mean, Bobby Lashley with Donald Trump versus Umaga with Vince McMahon, the Battle of the Billionaires, hair versus hair match of all things. It's amazing how much time this segment got, isn't it? Any segment with Vince McMahon in, he really made sure he got as much time as he really needed to, didn't he? This got a lot of video package time, match time, and, you know, filler time, kind of like at the end. Loads of time.
That's the thing about this. Obviously, it was one of the big things about this WrestleMania, the big draw, the big thing that the big talking point about this. Yes. And I'm thinking, with Vince McMahon involved, I think, of course, he was going to get as much time as he could. But the main thing is the match, it had two strong wrestlers in. But again, with these two, they didn't really go much further this.
No, they really, the manga really, they stopped his push at Cena. Bobby Lashley, again, they stopped his push at Cena. Two guys in WWE who really, in our both of our opinions, as you heard, really didn't get as much of a push in WWE as they probably should. And especially when they're in a match like this, you'd think that they would probably go on to bigger and better things. But later on, as we found out, Umaga died, of course, which is a shame. And Bobby Lashley just went out of WWE. But focusing on the match itself, I don't think the match itself was that bad. It's two bigger guys going at it. It was a decent match. It's just that, was there any other concentration on the two guys in the match? Or, you know, that's
well, my thought straight away is that the whole Stone Cold being the referee, that's the thing I want to bring up. Yeah. Is that, yes, Stone Cold at WrestleMania, wow, yes, everyone loves it. But in my opinion, he got a bit too involved in the match. If he screwed Vince at the end, that would have been a great ending thing. But we could tell that it was going to come to the way Austin was getting involved as much as he was. So in my opinion, Austin kind of let this match down quite a bit for me personally.
Yeah, but Umaga did spike him twice. So I don't know. That's my little argument there. But of course, you had Stone Cold getting the spike. The coast-to-coast was something good. There was a lot of overbooking in this match, but you expect that with Vince McMahon. You expect a drama match out of him. And, you know, essentially, we get the whole, what this match led to was the payoff of Vince McMahon getting his head shaved. It was a nice payoff. I'm just not sure the concentration was on the right place here. That's the only problem with me.
No, with this match being as big as it was built to it, it did, in my opinion, it had a good payoff at the end because it was what everyone wanted to see. But it just didn't do it much justice for me as it was meant to.
Yeah, and the feud continued on after for the ECW World title. You had the whole Vince Umaga and, you know, Shane McMahon versus Bobby Lashley. And again, that Bobby Lashley push never really went anywhere, did it? They kind of just stopped it.
No.
Bobby Lashley wanted to leave.
And Vince tried to destroy it by taking ECW Championship and doing all that. Yeah.
So overall, your Battle of the Billionaires, it was a good draw. It did what it's supposed to do in the sense that it gave you a payoff that you want to see. Vince McMahon, that's usually what they give. A Vince McMahon match will give you some kind of payoff. We've seen it at numerous WrestleManias now. Do you want to talk about the Divas match?
All I'll say is that with this, with the Lumber Jewel match, it did it just with getting enough Divas on the show. Like, instead of having just the odd 1-2 in a match, they did have quite a lot going. But the match itself,
3 minutes.
Sure, it had its points at the championship, but it just weren't the best of matches to have at WrestleMania.
Really good way to shit on the women's match, if I'm honest with you. You're right, 3 minutes. It was basically, this was used as Divas are used pretty much now. It was just a breather match, which the crowd could really care less about. Melina versus Ashley. I can't even really remember who won. I think it was Melina, and it was a Lumberjill match. I think that really says it all. It was just a break between that match and the main event.
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah, but the main event itself, though, John Cena versus Shawn Michaels for the WWE Championship. Shawn Michaels won a triple threat match between, I think it was him. It was himself, Edge and Orton, to get this shot. A match which was originally going to be Triple H versus Cena 2. Boy, am I glad they did Shawn Michaels versus Cena after this, because this was a fucking great match.
Well, there's two things I'll say. With Triple H again, maybe it would have been Triple H's win over it. I don't know what they would have done. But with this, Shawn Michaels getting a WrestleMania match, him to put another one over, it definitely did its justice to the main event of this WrestleMania.
It carried on Shawn Michaels' streak of really good to great WrestleMania matches, didn't it? I mean, you had John Cena entering in that car. The fans were blatantly on Michaels' side, as you would expect at a WrestleMania with John Cena in there. The match got 28 minutes. It really did tell a good story. You had Michaels targeting the knee, Cena overcoming the legend that is Shawn Michaels, and Shawn Michaels putting over the guy, the John Cena, who is still the face of the company now. You had the pile driver on the steps, the announcer's table spot they did. It was just a really, really good main event and a really good way to end the show despite all that filler. At least it gave you a really nice feeling, you know, at the end of the show. It left you feeling quite good because you had a great main event.
Well, the build-up to this main event kind of maybe took people's attention away because it had too much filler and the matches weren't as big as they could have been. But when it came to this match, you're going to get to see Shawn Michaels in a main event match for the championship. So there's a lot going for this match. And even though it's not going to be other past Shawn Michaels match, it was a big match that people wanted to see because obviously John Cena's some fan favourite, Shawn Michaels being the icon.
Yeah.
It had a lot going for it. Paid off brilliantly.
It did. I mean, the great thing about that pile driver on the step spot is that you don't see that very often in WWE now. So to see it on WrestleMania on Big Stage makes it have so much more impact. And when John Cena kicks out of the two, it just has so much more impact. Cena wins with the STFU, kind of similar to the way he beat Triple H, really, wasn't it? But a great WrestleMania main event, in my opinion. Really good. Told a good story. Guy won.
That's true. It built up to the ending. They kicked up each other's moves. It could have gone either way, but obviously it was Shawn Michaels putting John Cena over, and it didn't justice. It's a good way to wrap it up for Cena's career.
WrestleMania 23 overall thoughts then, NJ?
Well, obviously we didn't see a lot of it because we skipped quite a lot, because obviously it just really took away match time, which could have got more time.
Definitely.
And the match itself, we got a good match. I'm not going to give away the Money in the Bank, the Undertaker,
Batista,
and the main event. And obviously the billionaire match, but it had legends appearances, so it had to, obviously, which all WrestleManias do, the Hall of Fame. So had a lot going for it, but it's just our attention went because we had to skip so much because of the filler.
The filler was a big reason why this WrestleMania might not get as good a grade as it probably should have. It had 8 matches. I think a couple of them really did seem like filler matches, like the Women's Championship match, the Kane Great Khali match, the ECW match. But the main event delivered. The Money in the Bank was a good way to open the show. The Batista Undertaker match was good. The Battle of the Billionaires did what it was supposed to and give you a nice payoff. I mean, if it didn't have all the filler and had some other matches in it, I'd probably give it like a B, in the region of a B. But because of the fact it had so much filler in it and all that kind of stuff, and some of the matches didn't have great long-term consequences, it kind of gets a C+ from me. Just mainly because of the filler. Some of the matches delivered, but there was just a lot that seemed like filler on this show.
That's the thing, because the matches myself, they didn't really feel like big WrestleMania matches, so that lets it down for me. The right match got good length, I give it that.
Did.
But it's just that the whole main itself, building up to the match that I cared about, was a letdown, so I'm going to give it a C+.
A C+ is a fair grade. If you're going to be generous, you could give it a B-. It's one of those kind of shows, isn't it? You how do you grade it is very different. Is very differing compared to, you know, what you look at in terms of the filler and stuff. So some people would give it like a C plus, other people would give it a B minus. It's really perception. That's the problem. But our perception is probably more to a C plus. Really,
true. Yes.
Depends based on what we got from top to bottom of the show.
That's the way of putting it. Yes.
Yeah. Right. So that's been our review on WrestleMania 23. We've been going at it for 20 minutes now, NJ. So make sure you guys get your thoughts on this WrestleMania, because we want to hear your thoughts down in that comment section below. We hope you enjoyed the review and our review series continuing on to WrestleMania 27.
And all I can say now, people, is thank you for tuning in for another WrestleMania review. Next will be WrestleMania 24, so tune in for that. And all I can say now is hopefully you got some good things to say about this WrestleMania. Please leave them in the comment section below. And that has been it. From Mr. Parkin and me, NJ. All I can say now, people, is till next time, people, goodbye.